Lagi saya lupa mau record ini video. Okay. So for those who are watching the recording, I'm sorry. I started a little bit, baru saya teringat mau record. Okay. Remember to use cover page. Cover page gunalah size dengan spacing yang kamu diberikan. Biarlah dia besar sikit daripada yang lain. Ini pastikan dia di tengah, ini kalau boleh kasih cantik. Okay. So for case study one, you don't have to copy the whole thing yang ada tersalin diagram, tidak perlu salin diagram, delete that part, bazir ruang saja untuk kamu. Okay, and then you can go straight into case study one, the task A. For this one, memang dia suruh using a table, jadi kamu buatlah table. List down the enzyme and protein, and then state precisely in which step each enzyme or protein is used. I saw that a lot of you really explained at which stage and after which enzyme, baru enzyme ini masuk. So, ramai yang buat explanation yang sangat bagus, tapi untuk jimatkan masa kamu, kami cuma minta kamu pilih step macam ini saja. So, you tell me whether it is initiation, elongation, ataupun termination. Tapi kalau ikut pemahaman kita, termination memang tidak ada sebab dia akan terminate atau dia akan habis bila dia sampai di penghujung DNA. So it doesn't use any specific enzyme to stop termination. Okay, and so sama ada the initiation, elongation sahaja. Untuk primase, DNA polymerase 3 and DNA polymerase 1, saya terima initiation or elongation. Kalau ikut kamu punya syllabus sekarang, saya ajar yang primase, polymerase 3, polymerase 1 ini adalah elongation. Tapi kalau ikut buku Campbell Biology, which is the revision book or textbook that we use the most for biology, especially in your syllabus, in your level, menurut buku Campbell yang terkini, dia tidak pisahkan DNA transcription kepada initiation, elongation atau termination sudah. Sebab mereka rasa dia punya pembahagian stage untuk trans DNA replication kurang penting. Protein synthesis yang DNA kepada mRNA, mRNA kepada protein itu masih kita bagikan kepada tiga stage, initiation, elongation, termination. Tapi DNA replication, one DNA to produce a copy of itself, tidak ditekankan step. Tapi sebab assignment kamu sudah ditetapkan beberapa markah untuk bahagian ini, jadi saya ikut sahajalah untuk jimat kita masa. Kalau tidak nanti mau meeting lagi lah, mau kasih betul inilah, kasih betul itu. So I just give you the free mark here. I tell you it is initiation or elongation. Function ya, ini saya tidak nyatakan di sini. Pandai-pandai lah kamu cari di nota. You only need one sentence begitu untuk state the function. Okay, and then those of you who hand in, I will mark terus digitally. And you don't even have to copy the question. Kalau kamu mau salin lagi soalan untuk B, boleh. Tapi boleh teruskan saja dengan tulis B. Dan salin table tu. Isilah number di tepi. Is this the answer, Miss? I don't know. You don't check yourself. I don't know. I don't know. Pandai-pandai. Tulis ini. Okay, asalkan ada ini table, boleh sudah dapat 10 markah. Any question about case study one? Okay, no question. So I will move on to case study two. So case study two, soalan dia, choose only one gene sequence from the above and find the processes involved in the production of hormone. Explain each process briefly, blah, 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 blah. So ini saya bagi kamu rangka karangan. Okay, your essay should not exceed 250 words. So it should be very simple and straight to the point. Kalau kamu mau bagi ayat bunga-bunga, kamu mau bagi macam introduction. Okay, contoh introduction kamu adalah protein synthesis involves the transcription and translation process. Titik, cukup. If you want to add more, you can, but no, it doesn't bring any marks, so terpulang sama kamu. Okay, apa yang saya minta adalah bila kamu cakap pasal protein synthesis, kamu nyatakan, please state the words transcription and translation. Nyatakan. Lepas tu kamu explain, mungkin satu perenggan itu kamu gunakan untuk explain apa itu transcription. Transcription is the process of blah 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 blah. Titik. And then you can tell me the enzyme involved in transcription is satu saja, yaitu RNA polymerase. Transcription involves three steps, which is initiation, elongation, termination. The final product of transcription will be mRNA of the gene. And then sini kamu boleh tulislah, kalau contoh kamu pilih gene A, kamu tulislah di penghujung paragraph ini, gene A akan hasilkan mRNA apa. Just write it out. And then the next perenggan, the next paragraph, you can talk about translation. Same thing, you explain what is translation, you state the types of RNA involved, so itu adalah rRNA, bersama dengan mRNA dan tRNA. The three steps involved, and don't forget to state the sub-stages in elongation. So kamu boleh cakap, okay, it involves initiation, elongation, termination. In elongation, there are three sub-stages, which are and then you say what is the product. The product of translation should be the protein that is encoded for. Dan di hujung perenggan ini, kamu boleh tulis protein yang kamu hasilkan. Starting dengan methionine, blah, 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 sampai ke hujungnya. Okay. And you can also choose at the end of your paragraph, you can write macam ni. Ada yang lukis diagram, ada yang dia tulis di hujung paragraph, and that is fine too. This is your gene A, begini, dia ada error transcription, ada error translation. Bagi yang sudah hantar, bagus. Saya akan tanda, dan nanti kalau kamu mau adjust untuk ikut layout yang saya sarankan ini, you can. If you want to choose to continue with your own assignment layout that you submitted last week, that is fine too. Okay. Assignment saya akan cuba siap tanda hari ini dan bagi balik hari ini bagi yang sudah hantar. Any question regarding case study 2? If your question is, Miss, saya punya sudah tanda kan, Miss? Kalau sudah tanda, saya akan kasih balik terus. Kalau saya belum siap tanda, kamu belum terima. So, if your question is, bila saya boleh dapat balik draft saya, Miss? Jawapannya adalah bila saya siap tanda. Any questions regarding case study 2? Okay, thank you, Shiloh. Thank you, Shifa. Okay, no questions. I'm moving on to case study 3. So case study 3, you're interested to study the mutation in the regulatory gene like eye of an operon, which significantly alters the shape of repressor protein produced causing loss of function. By using separate label diagrams, describe briefly actions of the normal and mutated lac operon in the absence of lactose. So some of you choose to do this one. Okay, it's very good. You're challenging yourself. But a lot of you seems to still be misunderstanding what is a lac operon, or you don't understand what is the question asking for. Jadi sebelum saya explain bahagian kedua tu, saya mau go through sekali lagi pasal lac operon. So lac operon, or lac operon is the example of an operon that we usually use to teach people about operons. So kita ada gene, gene boleh hasilkan protein. Tapi kalau sentiasa transcribe gene, if we are constantly turning on the gene, it can use up a lot of resources in your cell. Cell kita macam kehabisan bahan, kehabisan tenaga, kalau dia sentiasa hasilkan protein, tapi dia tidak gunakan protein itu. An operon is how your cell or your organism turns off genes that it does not need right now. Operon adalah antara cara sel kita off gene yang dia tidak perlukan. The example you see here is lac operon, which is found in E. coli bacteria. When it is needed to digest lactose, it will turn on the operon. Bila tiada lactose, dan E. coli itu tidak perlu hadam lactose, dia akan turn off dia punya operon. Let us look at just this diagram. Yeah, let's just look at this diagram. This is a normal operon in the absence of lactose, which means in this E. coli, tiada susu, tiada lactose. Jadi dia perlu turn off dia punya lac operon. In the lac operon, we know that there is a regulatory gene called LacI yang akan hasilkan repressor. Dalam lac operon juga ada operator, promoter, dan structural genes. Structural genes like Z, lac Y, and lac A. So in a normal lac operon, in the absence of lactose, regulatory gene or lac I will be transcribed. It will be transcribed to produce mRNA. mRNA will be translated to produce repressor protein. Repressor protein, function dia adalah untuk bind to operator. The function of a repressor protein is to bind to operator, melekat kepada operator. Bila dia melekat kepada operator, RNA polymerase tidak dapat limpas. RNA polymerase can try to bind here at the blue part, at the green part, but it cannot go over the yellow part. RNA polymerase tidak dapat limpas yang bahagian kuning, jadi dia tidak akan dapat transcribe structural gene. Dia tidak dapat hasilkan mRNA untuk gene-gene yang di belakang ini, yang warna biru cair. Setakat ini boleh faham untuk lac operon, or do you have any questions about lac operon? So this here, this diagram I give, it's an example when the operon is turned off. Any questions at all? So far, tidak. Okay. We are still talking about normal lac operon. Sebelum saya pergi kepada mutated lac operon, I'm going to talk about the normal lac operon in the presence of lactose. Hold on. Yeah. I'm gonna do... Okay. I'm just checking if you can see my screen. Okay, you should be able to see this diagram now. Okay, so this diagram I have on the screen right now is an example of normal lac operon in the presence of lactose. So ini bila persekitaran E. coli itu ada sudah susu, susu mengandungi lactose. Okay. So now the E. coli knows that it has to turn on the lac operon so that it can produce the enzyme to digest the lactose. Sekarang ada sudah susu, dia perlu hadam susu, jadi dia perlu hasilkan enzyme untuk hadam itu susu. Cara dia turn on gene untuk hasilkan enzyme tersebut adalah the regulatory gene lac I is still producing mRNA, mRNA still produce repressor. So sekarang susu itu masuk ke dalam sel. Okay, the lactose will be changed to its isomer, which is allolactose. Allolactose is the same thing as lactose molecule, just the structure is arranged a little differently. Allolactose, which is an inducer in this case, will come to the repressor protein. Dia akan melekat kepada repressor protein. When the allolactose binds to the repressor protein, it induces a conformational change. Apa maksud ayat yang saya cakap tadi adalah bila allolactose datang dan melekat, dia akan mengubah bentuk repressor. Enzyme-enzyme protein-protein ini asal bentuk dia berubah, dia tidak dapat hasil, dia tidak dapat jalankan tugas dia yang sebelum ini sudah. So it can no longer bind to the operator. Tengok ini. Bila ada satu lactose melekat kepada dia, dia punya bentuk sudah berubah. Bahagian di atas ini tidak dapat sudah masuk bahagian yang kuning. So now your repressor is inactive. RNA polymerase yang sentiasa mengambil kesempatan untuk transcribe akan datang sini, dia akan bind dan dia akan transcribe structural genes. mRNA will be produced and then enzymes will be translated. Okay, ini adalah normal lactoferrin in the presence of lactose. Ada soalan berkenaan dengan normal lactoferrin in the presence of lactose, which is when it is switched on. Okay, looks like you don't have any questions. Now we will look, we will consider what happens when the lactoferrin is mutated. So kita tengok balik soalannya. Sekarang kita mau cuba jawab soalan. You are interested to study the mutation in the regulatory gene of a lactoferrin, which alters the shape of repressor protein produced, causing loss of function. Maksud ayat di sini adalah, sekarang regulatory gene kamu di sini ada mutation. Mutation dia menyebabkan repressor protein kamu berubah bentuk. So sekarang bentuk dia menjadi pelik. Because of the change in shape of the repressor protein produced, there is loss of function. Dia kehilangan dia punya kehilangan keupayaan untuk menjalankan tugasnya. It is unable to carry out the original function, so lose function, loss of function. Kalau repressor protein kamu tidak dapat jalankan tugas dia, bermaksud dia tidak akan dapat melekat kepada operator. Tidak dapat melekat kepada operator, operon sepatutnya off bila tiada lactose, disebabkan ini tidak dapat melekat di sini, ada lactose kah, tiada lactose kah, kamu punya operon akan sentiasa on. Let's see how I try to do that in a diagram. So you have to show diagram for this question. So question ini memang untuk show diagram yang first part, of course you can copy paste from somewhere else kan. But for the second diagram, you have to edit your own diagram. Kamu boleh lukis sendiri, kamu boleh conteng. If you want to add shapes, however, okay, ini saya main conteng di saya punya word. So this is an example of how we can explain that. Okay, di atas ini tidak perlu ubah apa-apa, mRNA tidak perlu ubah apa-apa. Protein sahaja kamu ubah bentuk dia. Ubahlah bentuk protein itu kepada bentuk yang menunjukkan dia tidak dapat melekat kepada operator. So for this one, how I saw it can no longer carry out its function, I remove the dua di atas tu supaya dia tidak dapat masuk di sini. Okay, so I change the shape of the repressor protein. In the diagram, I state that it is mutated. And then I choose a diagram that shows the structural the structural genes being transcribed and then translated. Diagram yang saya pilih di mana structural gene itu ditranscribe kepada mRNA dan mRNA dia ditranslate kepada protein ataupun enzyme-enzyme yang diperlukan. Explanation pada diagram juga saya ubah. Ini lactose absent, repressor non-functional, operon on. Walaupun tiada lactose di persekitaran ya, dia punya operon masih turn on. And anytime you are drawing, you are including a diagram, bila-bila masa kamu sertakan diagram dalam kerja-kerja kamu, cubalah label. So for this one, I label figure 1 diagram of normal lactoferrin in absence of lactose. This one I label diagram of mutated lac operon in the absence of lactose with non-functional repressor protein operon on. Untuk label diagram itu saja sudah ada satu marka. Diagram kamu betul, edit di tempat yang betul, boleh dapat dua marka. So you can lose 3 marks, okay, if you don't have the diagram. Okay, so when you do the explanation, you explain from transcription of LACI into the repressor. Repressor dapat melekat atau tidak, kamu cerita. Dan kamu cakaplah RNA polymerase dapat transcribe ataupun tidak. Whether the operon is switched on or switched off. Any questions regarding case study 3? Remember, for your work, you can choose to draw digitally, you can do it by hand. You want to draw your own diagram pun boleh, kalau tidak, cari di internet pun boleh. Saya nampak ada juga ramai yang main Google saja, tapi dia tidak tahu apa pun dia copy paste. Yang benda yang di luar silibus yang terlebih canggih untuk level kamu pun ada, main sakin saja. If you don't understand what is lac operon, you should have asked. You could have asked me, you could have asked a friend. And try to do your work by yourself. Kerja yang kami berikan adalah untuk peringkat kamu. Jadi kamu tidak perlu Google dan berhabis cari buku ilmiah yang terlebih mendalam untuk saling jawaban. For your level, especially, we give you questions that require you to think. So if you can think around, you can find the answer in your brain. Tidak semestinya semua perlu saling di internet. Okay, Evelista ask a question. Miss, yang mutated tu memang tiada di Google kan, Miss, untuk diagram dia? I don't know, I haven't searched Google. But I know that it's an easy diagram to draw. Kalau kamu lukis tangan pun, contoh diagram kamu, yang di atas cantikkan, berwarna kan, dari nota kan. Yang di bawah ni, kamu lukis tangan saja dengan hitam putihnya, dengan pensel yang dipadam-padam. Your pencil drawing can be more accurate than the internet ones. I think tiada di Google. Try to come up with it yourself. It's also a great chance for you, if you have the technology for it, to learn to edit things. Kamu boleh edit guna apa-apa cara saja. Ini peluang untuk kamu belajar lah. Any more questions? That do. Okay. Yang lain, ada lagi soalan? Ada lagi? Bagi yang sudah hantar assignment draft dengan jawapan yang di copy paste daripada Google, apa boleh buat lah. Nanti saya akan tanda besar pangkas saja. But at least now you know what I expect from you. I know I just gave you the PDF for this thing. Saya baru saja bagi PDF untuk ini dalam kamu punya Telegram. Tapi kalau saya nampak ada yang copy paste diagram saya satu biji, saya akan anggap diagram itu tidak wujud dalam draft kamu. Please come up with your own draft. Okay? Yang diagram pertama ni kamu mau salin dari mana-mana, it's okay, it's fine. Tapi diagram kedua itu mesti hasil kamu sendiri. Kalau kamu copy paste diagram saya tampilin kamu. Sekian. Ndalah, saya pergi pukul kamu, but like, I'm just gonna pretend the diagram is not there and I give you 0 marks. Okay, any more questions? Kalau saya nampak kelas, student kelas lain ada benda ni, atau sudahlah, kamu pasti share jawapan. Miss, kalau shape tu kami tukar shape lain, boleh? Yes, Intan, boleh. You can change to any shape to show that it can no longer bind to operator. any more questions, feel free to ask me. Oh, by the way, for those of you who are using Word, do you know about this thing called a page break? Where is it? So if you go to insert pages, you can include a page break. Okay, bagi yang guna Word lah. So instead of kata-kata enter untuk buka page baru, kamu boleh simply insert page break. Supaya kalau kamu delete satu baris, dia tidak akan terlarik the rest of the document. Di Google Docs pun boleh insert page break. Kamu cuma perlu pandai cari. The mobile version of Microsoft Word pun ada page break. Pandai-pandai cari. Soalan Evidista. Miss, kalau macam draft tu buat sendiri, tapi semua benda yang dalam diagram tu kami salin, boleh bahkan? What do you mean? Oh, contoh kalau diagram kedua ini kamu lukis sendiri, tapi kamu salin apa yang saya tulis. Contoh DNA, mRNA, protein, mutated, non-functional, repressor, semua ni. Okay, yes, you can do that, but it has to be hasil tangan sendiri. Okay, can evidence, no problem. Oh, right, one more thing. Don't forget your references. References boleh sertakan dua reference mengikut format citation APA. I think I showed you guys like the reference for Solomon and Campbell punya buku teks kan. I'm pretty sure I showed it to you somewhere before. So you can use those two in your assignment and also in your lab report. Kalau kamu sedang pikir, tapi Miss, kami tidak gunakan buku teks from Campbell ataupun Solomon, bolehkah tu kami masukkan saja di dalam kami punya assignment dengan lab report? Yes, you can. Because the lecture notes that we use to teach you uses information from the Campbell textbook and the Solomon textbook. Jadi kalau kamu gunakan dua reference itu untuk kamu punya assignment ataupun lab report, dihalalkan. Sebab maklumat dia dari lecture note dari buku textbook. But if you want to find your own sources, kalau kamu mau juga cari website sendiri, pastikan kamu cite ikut APA citation yang sebenar. Okay, any more question? Oh, one more. Cipa tanya, Miss, kalau bentuk repressor dia tuh melekat dekat operator, tapi mutated bahagian untuk lactoside boleh juga kan? Sebab masih tidak function juga kan tuh operator? Let me think. Okay. Shifa's question. Shifa asked a question. Bolehkah dia ubah bentuk operon itu kepada bentuk yang macam ini? Is this the diagram that you imagine, Shifa? Okay. Once again, for those who cannot see the chat, Shifa asked, kalau bentuk repressor dia melekat dekat operator, like this, tapi mutated bahagian untuk lactoside, Bolehkah? The answer is no, you cannot do this. Sebab mutation ini menyebabkan loss of function. Kalau begini, dia masih ada dia punya function, dia masih boleh jalankan function dia. So, it's not the lactose site that you should change. It is this site, the pointy site. So, ini tidak boleh diterima. But good question. Good question. Kamu tidak semestinya lukis bentuk macam ni lah. Kalau kamu mau lukis bentuk yang begini kah, itu represser protein kamu jadi bentuk macam ini pun boleh. Kalau dia jadi bentuk macam ini pun boleh. Kalau dia jadi bentuk macam ini pun boleh juga. No problem. As long as it cannot bind to the operator. Okay, last question. One more question before we go. Heart shape boleh. Okay, itu sudah last question lah. Okay, kalau ada soalan nanti, feel free to ask in the group. Okay, jangan malu-malu tanya di group. Kalau mau private pun boleh. Right. So, that is all for this part, I think. Itu saja saya mau cakap untuk bahagian assignment ini. Nanti saya sudah bagi balik draft, sila edit, betulkan mana yang perlu. Tapi kalau kamu tidak mau markah, kamu tidak edit pun tidak apa. Nanti mata rendah, kamu seorang saja yang satu markah, terpulang kerja kamu lah. Okay. If you submit late for the final draft, I will deduct your marks. Pastikan kamu cuba hantar on time dalam bentuk PDF melalui Google Classroom. Anything else I need to say regarding assignment, the deadline? The final deadline for assignment is 22nd of October. Okay. Once again, I am going to this thing. Okay, so once again, this is the deadline. Assignment final deadline 22nd on the Friday. Experiment video. Okay, this one I will return to you as soon as I can juga. So bagi yang belum siap edit, sila siapkan edit by this weekend. Lab report. The final deadline ini adalah hari di mana saya akan buat serentak. So those who have submitted the lab report, bagus, nanti kamu betulkan mana yang perlu betulkan sahaja, tidak perlu submit pembetulan. I just want on the 21st of October, I will give you the template for the final lab report. Kamu download lah, kamu print lah, kamu tulis lah dan kamu terus scan dan upload dalam 24 jam pada hari Khamis 21 hari bulan. I think you should be in college by then. So 21 hari bulan tu tiada excuse, tiada line lah, tidak sempat print lah, terlajak tidur kah, tidak dapat pergi kebun kah. So no such thing as excuses on the 21st. Data untuk final report itu, kamu gunakan balik data daripada video kamu yang berjaya. So jangan dulu buang kamu punya 4.0 punya measurement apa semua tu, use that for the final lab report. Saya tidak payahlah kasih awal ini sebab kalau kasih awal nanti kamu macam rushing pula kan. You also have the experiment to the video to edit, the assignment to work on. And I'm sure your other subject, you also have other works to do. Okay, any questions regarding the assignment and experiment? Okay, all right then. no other questions, we will take a break. A quick 3-minute break, and then I will go through chapter 7. Thank you. Now it's 9:15.
Miss?
Yes.
Do you want to finish chapter 7 today?
No.
How about the notes we use? We use from the website one.
You can use the one from the website, but I am editing it, so I will give you my version in Telegram later.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Miss.
Yeah, I need to drink water. You all also drink water. Okay, we are supposed to be back. I think Farahin's screen picture is from Squid Game. I haven't watched that yet. Is it good? Yes, Miss. Good. Okay. Nanti saya coba tengok lah. Cuti 1 minggu kan. Alright. I'm gonna share this thing. Hold on. I'm trying to share this. Lisha, kamu punya? Oh, right. Okay. The heads of men. Okay, sorry for this thing. I'm trying to open the Google Meet on my phone so I can see you chatting while I present this. Okay. All right. Okay. If you have any questions, feel free to ask in the chat. I'm going to start with the quick run through of the lesson. Okay. Memandangkan Miss kamu ini bukan orang yang sangat on time. Video pun saya belum apa? Video dengan lecture note pun saya belum siap edit. So this is what I'm going to give you for now, so you are not too far behind. Okay. So this chapter and the 1 week after cuti, you are going to learn about Chapter 7, Mutation. So, ini adalah slide yang saya ambil daripada website BioKML. Cuma saya belum siap edit, itulah saya belum send bagi kamu. So, yeah, we're going into mutation. And there are three subtopics in this chapter. So, you have 7.1, Mutation Classification and Types. 7.2, Gene Mutation. And 7.3, Chromosomal Mutation. 7.1 ini yang kita akan masuk for the first part. It's going to be very simple. And I hope that you're able to understand the points in this. Nah, dia sangat simple. Apa yang kami minta daripada kamu adalah kamu boleh bagi definisi mutation. Kamu boleh classify dia kepada gene and point mutation ataupun chromosome mutation. You can state two types of mutations, spontaneous and induced. And also you need to learn a bit more about mutagens. Okay. Anytime you hear the word mutation, mutation tidak semestinya sesuatu benda itu berubah kepada benda yang mula-mula dia tidak apa-apa cahaya, tapi lepas dia mutation dia terus jadi hijau kah, dia ada kuasa kah. Doesn't necessarily have to be that. Mutation is as long as you have a permanent change in the genetic information or DNA of an organism. That is mutation. Asalkan DNA kamu ada terubah, walaupun sedikit kecil saja perubahan itu, itu sudah mutation. As long as it's different from the original, mutation. And it can be passed to the next generation. Kalau mutation itu berlaku kepada kulit kamu, okay, kepada sel-sel di kulit kamu, then the cell-cell on your skin will not be passed to your children. If the mutation happened in your sperm or in your ovum cells, or it happened in the cells that will produce sperm and ovum, sperm or ovum, then that mutation can be passed to the next generation. Mutation boleh berlaku di mana-mana saja, mana-mana sel di badan kamu. Tapi kalau dia berlaku pada ovum dengan sperm, then dia akan kena pass kepada generasi seterusnya. I did share the screen. Can you see the screen? Oh, no, pandainya aku. Ya ampun, shock sendiri aku. Wait. Okay. Okay, thank you for telling me. So this was the slide I was talking about. Okay, 7.1, 7.2, 7.3. Okay, and then the learning outcome, define mutation, classify mutation, state two types of mutation, define mutagen, and state the types of mutagen. Okay, thank you. Right, and then this is mutation. Ini adalah definisi untuk mutation, a permanent change in the genetic information or DNA of an organism. And then if this happens in your sperm or ovum, it can be passed to the next generation. Okay, all right. So usually when we say the word mutant, you think about organisms that have changed very drastically. So the common examples of mutant cartoons are these. Okay, but actually when we say mutant, it is any organism that is carrying a mutated gene or a gene that has undergone a mutation. Biasanya kita gunakan perkataan ini untuk eksperimen. Okay, we usually use the word mutant when we are conducting experiment dan kita tahu mana satu gene yang original, mana satu gene yang mutant. Please don't go to a person with Down syndrome and call them a mutant. Okay, you use this for experiment and biological context. Don't talk to people and call them mutant. That is called being an asshole. Don't be orang jahat yang pergi maki-maki orang yang apa, yang cacat. Okay, right. So use the word mutant to describe an organism carrying a mutated gene in the biological context. Okay, so an example when we would call an organism a mutant is this. So you have the normal fruit fly. Okay, ini adalah lalat buah yang diberi nama scientific Drosophila melanogaster. Drosophila melanogaster is an example of organism that is a model organism. Okay, bila kita jalankan eksperimen, especially in biology, we have several favorite organisms. Okay, perkataan model organism ini digunakan untuk describe beberapa organisme yang kita biasa jalankan eksperimen dan kita sudah cukup biasa dengan eksperimen itu. So example of model organism is Drosophila melanogaster. We already know what it looks like. We know what the chromosome look like. We even know where exactly on the chromosome is the gene that we want. Other examples of model organism is lab rats. Contoh dia. Okay, itu macam maklumat tambahan lah. Apa itu model organism? Let's talk about this fruit fly. The normal fruit fly will have one pair of wings. So dia ada satu pasang sudah sayap that extends from a thorax. Ini adalah kepala dia, so the head, thorax, dada dia, atau thorax lah, dan abdomen. So it's supposed to have only one and one set of wings. It is supposed to have vestigial wings here. Kamu nampak di antara thorax dengan abdomen dia macam ada satu segmen dengan sayap yang tidak terbentuk. Undeveloped wings here. But in this mutant example, okay, in that large batch of Drosophila, there are some mutant flies. The mutant flies will look like this. It has changes in bithorax, a gene regulating a critical stage of development, causing it to possess two thoracic segments and thus two wings. Gene yang tentukan, okay, sel ini jadi thorax, sel ini jadi kepala, sel ini jadi abdomen, ada mutation. There's a mutation in this part of his gene, so that instead of the thorax looking like this, dia terdouble. Dia double dan sekarang lalat ini ada dua pasang sayap. So this is an example of one gene mutation causing the whole phenotype to change. Tolong jangan pergi tangkap lalat untuk cari ini ya. It's rare to find in nature. Okay, so that brings us to the next part. When we talk about mutation, which is any changes in DNA, we can classify it into two types and two classes. Okay, there's two types of mutation. Ada mutation yang secara spontan, bila-bila masa boleh berlaku, dan mutation yang induced, disebabkan oleh sesuatu. Ataupun kita boleh juga bahagikan mutation kepada dua class, two classes of mutation, which is gene or point mutation or chromosomal mutation. Okay, so types of mutation, you have spontaneous, you have induced. Spontaneous occur in natural condition. They can be caused by mistakes in base pairing or arrangement. So, first example is error in DNA replication. So, kamu belajar sudah DNA replication dalam chapter 6. Kadang-kadang DNA replication itu terpelik. Bila dia pelik, okay, so sometimes it goes beautifully and you have a good copy of DNA. Sometimes masa dia tambah DNA nucleotides itu dia tersilap letak. maybe it will put the wrong DNA nucleotide by mistake. And then the other enzyme tidak kasih betul ya. So that is example of error in DNA replication, that is spontaneous mutation. The second example is non-disjunction during gamete formation. So ini adalah contoh dia lah. Sepatutnya satu kromosom dibelah yang X begini, dia belah, dia jadi macam ni. Tapi kadang-kadang dia salah. Ada yang pergi sini, ada yang pergi sana, ada yang terlebih, ada yang kurang. That is non-disjunction. Okay, so this is extra information about non-disjunction. So far, okay, can you follow? Do you have any questions? Okay, yeah. Okay, then I'll move on to the next part. All right, for induced mutation will be caused by something. The something is called mutagen. Induced means disebabkan ataupun di-trigger oleh mutagen. Okay, so mutagen is a chemical or physical agent that can interact with DNA and cause mutation. We have physical mutagen, chemical mutagen. Itu definisi dia. So, an example in popular media is the Hulk. The Hulk is a scientist, Bruce Banner, who was exposed to gamma rays during a failed experiment, and that turned him into this version of the superhero that you guys know from Marvel. Okay, so when we talk about gamma ray, can you guess if gamma ray is an example of a physical or chemical mutagen? Sinaran gamma adalah physical ataupun chemical mutagen?
Physical.
Yes, correct. It is a physical mutagen. So examples of physical mutagens are ultraviolet rays, gamma rays, and X-rays. Yes, it's the same X-rays that you have in the hospital when you go for the medical checkup. Tapi dia bergantung juga kepada bilangan. Okay, so it also depends on the amount or the amount of exposure or the time of exposure. Kalau kamu didedahkan kepada gamma ray yang banyak, masa yang singkat, mutated lah kamu punya DNA. Kalau sekejap-sekejap saja, okay, dan pada bilangan yang sedikit, you might be safe. Okay, examples of chemical agents or chemical mutagens are colchicine and ethidium bromide. Okay, so in this diagram here, I have example of DNA being mutated by ultraviolet light. UV ray itu menyebabkan thymine dimer terbentuk. So dia tidak melekat, dia tidak form hydrogen bond dengan adenine yang di sebelah, tapi dia berpegang tangan dengan thymine yang di sebelah dia. And this is example of chemical mutagen colchicine. So colchicine will disturb the mitosis process. Kalau mitosis, sepatutnya kromosom itu terpisahkan, membentuk dua sel. Dan pemisahan kromosom itu dibantu oleh mitotic spindle ataupun spindle fiber. Chemical mutagen colchicine akan meracunkan atau merosakkan spindle fiber itu, menyebabkan semasa mitosis, kromosom-kromosom tidak terpisah kepada dua sel yang berbeza. So dia jadi macam one big cell with double number of chromosome because the chromosomes cannot be pulled apart. So that is how colchicine can cause mutation in plants, for example. You can also, okay, so in the second line, colchicine is also used to prevent tumor cells from dividing in certain chemotherapy treatments. Tumor cells, referring to like cancer cells, you can prevent them from spreading by poisoning them with colchicine. Tapi bukan semua chemotherapy akan gunakan cara ini. The reason why we use colchicine for agriculture, kenapa kita gunakan colchicine dalam pertanian adalah kalau dia punya kromosom tidak terpisah, dia tidak terpisah jadi dua sel yang berbeza, dia akan hasilkan buah yang lebih besar. So this means you can have bigger fruits, bigger profits. We will talk more about this phenomena when we go into 7.3. Okay, ini 7.1 ringkas saja nih. So, yeah, this is what I was talking about just now. How a normal mitosis should be. Okay, right. So the second one is the class of mutation. When we talk about class of mutation, kita boleh bezakan dia kepada dua, yaitu dua jenis, yaitu gene mutation or point mutation and chromosomal mutation. Gene mutation is when the mutation only happens at the gene level, at a single nucleotide pair. So it can be base substitution, insertion, deletion, and inversion. Ini kamu akan masuk dalam 7.2. Chromosomal mutation, change in genes due to alteration of chromosome structure or number. This one is 7.3. You have chromosomal aberration and chromosomal number alteration. Chromosomal aberration terbagi kepada empat jenis juga. Chromosomal number alteration dibagi kepada dua jenis. Don't worry, you are going to go through this in more detail in 7.2 and 7.3. Okay, so quick summary. Mutation, ada two types, spontaneous, induced. Ada two classes, gene mutation or chromosomal mutation. Ingat definisi untuk mutation. Ingat apa dua class mutation. Ingat apa dua types mutation. Dan ingatlah apa itu mutagen. Ingatlah contoh untuk mutagen. Okay, and then you can come up with your own notes and answer tutorial question. Tutorial question. Is there anything edited kah? Macam. Okay, the tutorial questions, you can use the ones from the website for now. Macam ada pembetulan sedikit pada salah satu soalan, tapi itu nanti saya mention dalam dalam Telegram sajalah. Lepas saya jumpa pembetulan itu. Okay, and in 7.2, you are going to go into gene mutation, but I think it's better if I let you digest this on your own, sebab macam kita punya call pun lebih dari satu jam sudah kan, mana tahu kamu rasa tidak tahan mau bergerak-gerak. Okay, so that is it for now. Nanti saya bagi Google Form, saya bagi tutorial questions untuk kamu buat. Terus apa? Video untuk kamu tengok. Nanti saya siap upload video, saya bagi tahu. Okay. Any questions? Ada masalah dengan 7.1? Kalau tidak, kita boleh habiskan kelas. Okay. All right, thank you. Then in that case, I will end the class. Okay. Elisha, apa kamu punya gambar sekarang tuh? All right, so thank you everybody. That is it for this part of the lesson. I'm going to stop the recording. Itu saja.